My name is Kathy Banks, Megan's mom, Cody's mother-in-law. It's because of them that I'm at the church. I went through a divorce several years ago after being married for almost 34 years. And at that time, I decided that I was tired of living my life for everybody else. I indulged myself, was self-absorbed, and much to my children's dismay, they would look at me and say, "Who are you and what did you do with my mother?" So I was like not the person that they grew up with. I know that my kids were praying for me, and I know that their church, which is this church now, was praying for me, slowly started coming back. And I think probably because you're never happy when you're self-absorbed. You're never happy when you only think about yourself. This church was meeting over in Tulsa. I started going over there mostly because Megan was singing. And so, you know, as a mom, I wanted to hear my daughter sing. But as I went there, God started using this church and the people in this church and the staff to start speaking to my heart. And eventually started putting all those broken pieces of my life back together. So that's kind of how I ended up here. And it's been a journey. This church is amazing. Since I have been back on the right path, back at home where I needed to be with God, He has met so many of my needs, so many questions that I had in my life, He's answered. He's given me a purpose, and I'm really thankful for that. It's amazing. In my lifetime, I've been a Christian since I was 23, and over the years, have probably had two pastors that I feel are truly, truly men of God, and I believe that Johnny is one of them. God said about David, He said that David was a man after His own heart. And I believe that about Johnny as well. And He said he's a man after His own heart because he did what God asked him to do. And I believe that God would not put a vision on Johnny's heart unless He knew that Johnny would do that. So He knows how dedicated he is to the work of God. From the time I walked in the doors till now, God has absolutely done a total 180. And I have a peace, and it talks about in the Bible, it talks about a peace that transcends our understanding. I feel His presence. And that is so amazing to me, to know that He's right next to me, to have the assurance that absolutely nothing is going to happen in my life that He doesn't already know about and that He's not going to take care of. He's already taken care of everything. And I didn't used to feel that. I believe He was always there, but I didn't always feel it. So it's just that awareness now of His presence and knowing that He's with me. If you're running from God, you have to know that you're on a dead-end street, first of all. You can run, and you can run, and you can run. You can't run far enough to get away from God. Jesus leaves the 99 to go after that one. And having been that one that He came after, I would tell you that maybe it's time to stop running, look at what's going on, but look to God, because He has the answers that you're looking for. As you get older, you think about different kinds of things. I think about, what is my legacy going to be when I'm gone? Well, obviously, people aren't going to remember me 100 years from now or 200 years from now. They will not remember me, but they can remember what we do as a church. I think that the new building is going to give us the opportunity to reach people who are hurting, who are broken, and who are lost. What better legacy could I leave than being able to invest in this church so that it can reach more lives for God, for heaven, for the kingdom of God? Because that's what's going to last. So maybe someday my legacy will be in heaven and somebody will come up and go, "Hey, I am so glad that you gave to that building fund back in the day." And I'll go, "Wow, really? I just didn't think it would have that kind of an impact." But it will have that kind of an impact because God will use that to reach people for Him.
John 2:1-11 says this: "On the third day, a wedding took place at Cana in Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine was gone, Jesus' mother said to him, 'They have no more wine.' And Jesus said, 'Woman, why do you involve me? My hour has not yet come.' And his mother said to the servants, 'Do whatever he tells you.' Nearby stood six stone water jars, the kind used for the Jews' ceremonial washing, each holding 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, 'Fill the jars with water.' So they filled them to the brim. And then he told them, 'Now draw some out, take it to the master of the banquet.' And they did so, and the master of the banquet tasted the water and what had been turned into wine. And he did not realize where it had come from, though the servants who had drew it, who had drew the water knew. Then he called the bridegroom aside and he said, 'Everyone brings out the choice wine first, and then the cheaper wine after the guest has had too much to drink. But you have saved the best till now.' What Jesus did here in Cana of Galilee was the first of the signs through which he revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him." This week has, it's been an interesting week. It's been a hard week. But one thing that I do is on Fridays, the offices are closed, and that's the day that I come up. I shut the door. I don't turn any lights on, so it doesn't look like anybody's there. I shut the door and I spend the day studying. And that's for the purposes of, if the lights are on, people are always coming up to the church, needing things and asking for prayer or whatever it is. And not that we don't want to do that, but I just, I've got to create that time and that space in order to study to be ready for Sundays. And so Heather called me Friday, and as I was studying, and she said, "Hey," she goes, "there's a woman who wants to come by. She can't make it to church on Sunday. She has to work, and she wants to bring her commitment, her offering by." And she said, "Can she just run that up there?" And I said, "Absolutely." And so I was sitting in my office, and a little while later, she knocked on my door, and we walked over here, and I got her an envelope, and she just started talking to me and sharing with me what was on her heart and what God was doing. And she just said, she goes, we used to come to church all the time, but my job changed and now I work on Sundays. So we go to church online with you now and we're able to watch it online together." And she goes, "But I want us to be a part of what God is doing. And I want to make sure that we're able to be a part." And she goes, "Johnny, honestly," she said, we've really been struggling. She goes, "We're trying to be obedient and follow God in everything that he wants to do." And she said, "But here's the hard thing." She said, "We don't have a lot of money." And she said, "So trusting God with our money and our finances is really hard for us." She said, "Because we don't have anything." And she said, "So we've been withholding from God." And she goes, "I was laying in bed the other night and God woke me up in the middle of the night. And," she goes, "I knew what I was supposed to do." And she goes, "So I've come up here today." And she goes, "And I want to give," she goes, "everything that we have." And in that moment, she began digging through her purse. And she goes, because if I know. She goes, if I don't give it now, she goes, I'm going to go spend it on something. And she goes, I want the blessing of God on our life. And I want the blessing of God. And she goes, so I don't want to withhold anything. And she goes, there's a story in the Bible, and she said, of a widow. And she said she didn't have much, but she brought everything that she had. She goes, that's what God laid on my heart. And so what she did is she got the envelope, and she put money in the envelope. And then she started dumping her purse out and going through her purse to make sure that she had put everything she had in the envelope. And the crazy thing is, Heather and I, we've had gifts before. We've had people give before. But this one moved me so much. Because from the beginning, what Heather and I have been challenging you to do is it's not about an amount of money. It's not about the amount of zeros that you can put at the end. It's about you saying yes to God and being obedient to what He has called you to do. That's all it's ever been about. And there is a woman who walks in here and stands right back there at the back of the worship center and puts everything that she has into an envelope and gives it to us because she said she wants the blessing of God on her life. Here's the crazy thing. It's $18. Everything she had was $18. See, some of you have walked in here thinking, I don't know how I can be a part. I don't know what my part can be in this because I don't have much. And God's saying it's never about the amount. It's always been about the heart. Because God's not trying to get the money out of us. He's trying to get to our hearts so that then there can be a massive move of God. Because the world has yet to see what one man fully devoted to God can do. The world has yet to see what a church fully devoted to Him can do. That's what it's about. And we've got story after story of people who have come by, who have called and said, hey, we're unable to be there today. We can't make it, but here's the thing. We want to be a part. And so, you know, here's our amount. Here's what we're doing. And here's what we want to be involved in. And here's how we want to give. And here's how we want to be a part of what God's doing. Story after story. And then there's other stories of people where we sit down and they say, God's given us an amount. And I don't know how it's possible for us to do this. We are literally stepping out of the boat and stepping out into faith to be obedient to what God has called us to do. Because I don't know what the future looks like. And I don't know how we're going to do it. And so my challenge to you today is this. Just be obedient to what God has called you to do. Just say yes. That's all it's ever been about. Because the world is yet to see what one church fully devoted to Him can do for the kingdom. And that we want to be that church. We want to be the ones that are used by God in such a mighty way. And so today I want to share this story with you. It's the first miracle that Jesus ever performed. And it's interesting because the scene here is Jesus is invited to a wedding with His disciples. Jesus' mother is at the wedding. And these weddings last a couple days. And so now as the wedding is going on, all of a sudden the wine runs out. And you can imagine as the father of the bride how embarrassing that is. You can imagine how, I can't believe this has run out. Like I'm supposed to be providing for these people and now all of a sudden the wine has run out. There's no more. And you can imagine the embarrassment that falls on that person. And Jesus' mother, somehow we don't understand and know all the details, but somehow she gets word that this took place. And Jesus' mother walks over to Him and says, hey, Jesus, hey, they've run out of wine. Okay, I'm a carpenter. What does that have to do with me? And Jesus' mother looks at the servants and goes, hey, just do whatever He tells you to do. Just do whatever He tells you to do. See, I don't know if Mary at that time understood how powerful that statement is. I don't know if Mary understood how strong those words are. That Jesus' first miracle is Mary looking at him and telling these servants, do what Jesus says. Listen, this is the story of the gospel. This is sanctification. This is you and I becoming more like Jesus. If we will just step forward and do what Jesus tells us to do. And see, Jesus' mother right there, she doesn't care what Jesus says. She just looks over. Why? Because she's seen Jesus for the past 30 years. And she knows who Jesus is. And she knows the ability that is in Jesus. And so she knows that the embarrassment that falls on these people. And here's the incredible thing about this miracle. That this is one of very few miracles that Jesus performs that has nothing to do with healing. Because normally in Scripture, what we see is we see Jesus laying hands on somebody and they're raising from the dead. We see Jesus touching eyes and all of a sudden they can see, touching ears and all of a sudden they can hear, touching mouths and all of a sudden they can speak, touching arms, touching legs and all of a sudden they can walk and they can move. Touching a disease and all of a sudden it goes away. But in this moment, here's the thing. It wasn't any of those. It was just a man who felt embarrassed because he ran out of wine. In that moment, that man was embarrassed because he could not provide. And we don't know the background. We don't know what took place. We don't know if he was a wealthy man and had plenty of money in order to provide, and more people showed up than he was expecting, and so he just ran out. We don't know if he didn't have very much money and he did all that he could, and then he ran out. All we know is that in this moment, he's out. And everybody's talking about it. And here's what you have to understand from the very first miracle of Jesus. See, what Jesus wants to do is he wants you to understand that even the little things that nobody else cares about, he cares about. That Jesus is willing to step into moments in your life where it's not a big deal to somebody else. Where it doesn't matter to somebody else. But he steps in and he says, when your heart is broken, when your heart is breaking, you have to understand, I care. And it matters to me. And I want to step in and I want to do something great, even when nobody else cares about what's going on. Even when nobody else sees it as a big deal. And so Jesus standing there looks at six servants and he says, hey, I want you to go get these six pots. And they were ceremonial washing pots. And they were about 20 to 30 gallons each. Big, massive pots. And what you would do is you walk up. You have to understand in the time, they didn't have paved roads. They didn't have cars. And so they were riding camels and donkeys. And they were walking down dusty roads. So when you would get to a place, you would clean up before you went in. And so they would have these pots that you could wash and you could rinse off and you could get clean before you go into the ceremony. And so Jesus says, I want you to take those pots and I want you to go fill them with water. Well, as the servants take them over there, they can't just fill them with water because nobody wants to drink out of a pot where people's hands and people's dirt and people's junk has been in. So they have to begin to wash those pots out. And so what you have to understand, in order for God to use you mightily, he's got to start working in you before he can start working through you. So he's got to clean some stuff out of you and he's got to make room for him before he can ever really use you the way that he desires to use you. See, what you have to see right here is Psalms 51:10. It says this, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit in me. And then it says this, rejoice to me the joy of my salvation. And so what you have to understand is what God is trying to do in this moment is he's trying to clean you and I out because there's things that have been put in the pot. There's things as we walk by on a daily basis that we continue to be influenced by. And God's saying, I want you to have a pure heart. I want you to have a clean heart. I want you to be filled with me and not the things of the world. And so maybe it is right now what God's been trying to do through this process is he's been trying to empty you of the world. And he's been trying to empty you of the things that you've allowed into your life. And he's saying, that's not what I desire for you. That's not what I want for you. That's not who you are. And so before God can work through you, he's got to begin to work in you. Maybe it's the envy that's in your life. And maybe there's some envy and you're dealing with envy. Maybe there's some lust. And all of a sudden he begins to work in you and he begins to clean out and he begins to get that dirt, because what they did is they would go and they would clean and they would scrub and they would scrub and then they would rinse it with water and they would look and they would see it's still a little dirty and they would begin to clean some more and they would begin to rub the inside of the pot to make sure that everything's out before they fill it with water. And maybe it's not just lust, maybe it's anger. Maybe God's working on your anger and he's trying to deal and he's trying to get you to not live for who you are and live in the past of who you've been, but understand that you are a new creation. Old things have passed away and behold, all things have become brand new. Maybe it's not that. Maybe it's pride. And God's trying to wash you clean of pride so that he can be filled with, so that he can fill all of you. Or maybe it's greed. And you look and you say, life is about me. Life is about what I want. And then the Bible says an interesting thing. After they filled the waters, it says this: they filled the waters to the brim. See, what you have to understand is they filled it to where nothing else could be put in it. Don't miss. You've got to understand what Jesus wants to do in your life. He wants to clean you out so that then he can fill you with all of himself, where there is no room for something else, where there is no room for anything else to wash in your life, to be in your life. And so we fill ourselves totally and completely with who God is. And it says they filled it to the brim and brought it to Jesus. Listen, some of you aren't trusting Jesus. So you'll be obedient, and when God says, go fill it with water, you fill it to about here. But then you begin to look, and you're just like, I mean, man, the master's going to get really mad if I bring back water. He's going to want some wine. So what I'm going to do is run to the store. God said, you know, put some water in here. So I'm going to put some water in here, but then I'm going to go dump some wine in there. They've already had enough. They're feeling pretty good, so I can dilute it a little bit. I don't have to waste all that. And so that's how we are a lot of times. But what God is saying and what God desires is he wants to fill all of us and not leave room for any excuses, not leave room for anything else. But he wants to fill us to the point to where we say, there is nothing else that can be put into my life. I am filled to the brim with Jesus. Create in me a clean heart. Purify my heart, God. And so he brings it back, and here's the thing. When they get back, Jesus reaches in, and he grabs a scoop, and he hands it to his servant, and he says, hey, here, take this over to the master. Have him taste it. And they carry it over to the master, and he takes a drink. And what they had filled was water, but what Jesus did is a miracle when he turned it into wine. See, what you have to understand, you're not responsible for the miracle. You're just responsible for carrying the miracle. Amen. Let me say, you're not responsible for the miracle. You're just responsible for being obedient and carrying the miracle for Jesus. See, what you have to understand, this building and what is going to take place in it, you're not responsible for. But what you are responsible for is carrying the miracle so that people can see God do what only God can do. We carry the miracle. Jesus does the miracle. And so those servants carried that miracle over. And he took a drink. He was like, this is the greatest thing I've ever tasted. See, what you have to understand, when we get into the new building, what we're carrying today, what people are going to see, what people are going to experience is this. People are going to experience hope. We're carrying hope for them. And so when we step out in faith and we're obedient to what God has called us to do, we are carrying hope for them. Hope for a greater future. Hope for that what God has done in your life can happen in their life. That how God has worked in you, God can work in them. And they're seeing the hope of the future because of you, because of the miracle that you are carrying. And maybe it's not just hope. Maybe it's healing. Maybe it's healing. When we step into that new building, listen, the same God who worked in the Bible is the same God that's working today. Miracles are still taking place. Miracles are still happening. And you are going to carry healing to people. You're going to heal. You're going to see miracles take place of people who go to the doctor and God, and the doctor says, listen, they're filled with cancer. There's no hope. Listen, you've got a disease. You've got a sickness. And there's no hope. Maybe it's a child. Maybe it's deaf ears. Maybe it's blind eyes. Maybe it's somebody who can't use their legs. The same God who performed miracles in the Bible is the same God who works today. And what you and I have the opportunity to do is to carry the miracle for people. Carry a miracle where God wants to step in and God wants to work. And all we get to do is we just get to be a part. It's not in my hands. It's not in my control. It's in God's hands. And God's, but I get to see what God's going to do. I get to carry it. See, maybe it is a miracle. Maybe it's a miracle of God restoring marriages. Maybe it's a miracle of a marriage that just seems like it's on the verge of collapse. And God steps in and God does something when the husband and wife come through the doors of the church. God starts to break down the hard hearts. God starts to heal and mend and do what only God can do. Maybe it's a couple who's been praying for a child, but they've been unable to get pregnant. And maybe God steps in and touches a womb and opens up that womb and they get pregnant. Maybe it's just the people that are going to walk through the doors of the church. Maybe that's the miracle. Maybe it's your spouse that you've been praying for. Maybe it's your kids that have run from God and you've been praying that God would get a hold of their heart and God would draw them back to Him. Maybe it's family members that are far from God and they want nothing to do with God. See, maybe that's the miracle that you are carrying. That's the miracle that God's going to do. Maybe it's salvation. Maybe it's a miracle of God taking our sins and giving us eternal life with Him forever through Jesus Christ. See, you have to understand, there is a miracle that God is going to work. And you and I get to carry that miracle today. God's not asking us to perform a miracle. God's just asking us to carry the miracle. See, our only response is this, is doing what Jesus' mother said. Jesus' mother just looked at the servants and said, do what He told you. Do what He told you. See, Jesus looks at her and says, Mom, what do you want of me? What do you want me to do? And she looks at the servants. She doesn't even respond to Jesus. She just looks at the servants and says, do what He told you to do. See, our prayer from the beginning has been this. Just be obedient. Do what He's told you to do. That's it. You want the blessing of God in your life? Then do what He told you to do. You will never have God's blessing if you will not do what He's told you to do. If you want God's blessing, it is always yes, no matter what. And so you and I today get to carry the miracle. And we get to look and we get to see a future that is brighter. A future that is bigger. A future that is greater. And we get to be a part of that. And we get to carry this miracle and say, man, what takes place in this building from now until eternity, I played a role in that. I didn't do much. Listen, we don't even know the servants' names. We don't have a clue who they are. We don't even know how many there were. All we know is there were 6 jars. See, they may not know our name. They may not be able to say who we are. But here's the thing, God does. And God's the one that promises blessing. And God's the one that changes everything. And so in order for God to work through us, He has to first work in us. Will your response today just be yes? Yes. Hey, do what Jesus tells you to do. Do what Jesus tells you to do. That's it. That's it. $18. God's not after an amount. He's after your heart. Because the world has yet to see what one church fully devoted to Him can do. God wants your heart. $18. She dug through her purse. She dumped it out to make sure she got everything in there. Here's what I want us to do right now. I want to pray for our staff and for some leadership that's going to be in the back. And what they're going to do is they're going to go back and they're going to give their commitment. And as they give their commitment, what I want us to do is we're going to pray and I'm going to pray over you. And then during these two songs, after I pray, we're going to sing two songs. And during these two songs, here's what I want you to do. I want you to take the commitment that God has laid on your heart. And I want you to take it and I want you to drop it in those boxes right back there. And then after you get done, the staff and the leadership is going to pray over you. And so as they pray over you, and they pray God's blessing over you, listen, I don't know what God's going to do, but I know this. Just be obedient to what He says. Just do what He says.